Good evening. Our guest this evening is the writer, editor, and actor, Joan Juliet Buck. For most of her professional career, Joan has invited us to read about the lives of cultural icons and reflect on some of our society's most significant trends. Tonight, she's here to discuss her fantastic memoir, The Price of Illusion, which details her own remarkable life, full of eccentric personalities, priceless opportunities, and unexpected outcomes. "I don't know if I can figure people out," she says, "but I do understand things through color." She tackles life with all of her senses, an eye for color, a nose for stories, an ear for the unheard of, a seductive touch, and a taste for adventure. And after reading her book, I'd add that she also has a sixth sense, a heightened awareness about what is left untold. Born in Los Angeles, Joan's father, Jules Buck, was an American film producer, and her mother, Joyce, a model, actress, and interior designer. And when she was a young girl, her family moved to France in the midst of the McCarthy era. "My entire life has been shaped by the fact that I learned French at the age of 3, she says. Famous faces appeared throughout her childhood: John Huston, Peter O'Toole, Lauren Bacall, and Federico Fellini. And for years, she shuttled between Los Angeles, Paris, Cannes, Ireland, New York, and London. Her life moved at a very fast clip, and by 23, she was features editor of British Vogue. She made a name for herself at publications including Women's Wear Daily, Vanity Fair, Interview, and the London Observer. And in 1994, she became the first and the only American editor-in-chief of French Vogue. It was such a glamorous life, or so it appeared. "I always wanted the imaginary to be real," says Joan. And tonight, she's here to discuss The Price of Illusion. Please join me in welcoming Joan Juliet Buck.
Thank you for having me, Melissa.
Joan, you open your book with a beautiful sentence that's short, but deeply symbolic, that I'd like to read. "For expatriates, there is no firm ground." Why did you decide to start here?
When you're writing a book about your life, a memoir, but memoir is supposed to be small, this got bigger, you try and figure out where you came from. And I come from this thing of expatriates, people who willingly leave the country they're in. So that's very different than being a refugee. Expatriates who, particularly in the 50s, thought, this has gone on with Americans in Europe all through the 20th century or the 19th century. "Oh, wouldn't it be fun to live in Paris?" And wouldn't it be fun to live in London? There are wonderful books about such people. And of course, Henry James wrote about the Americans who thought it would be fun to live in Florence. So when you do that, when your family leaves the country they belong to and go to a more attractive, more interesting country, you grow up in this wonderful atmosphere that's better than what you would have known at home, or more interesting, but you don't actually belong where you grew up, and even though you speak the language of where you grew up, you're not of that nationality. And then when you try and go home, you actually have the other country inside you. So the moment you become an expatriate, it's like you got on one of those shuttles to Mars and you're actually never coming back to the same planet Earth that you left. And you'll always be looking for a map. By the way, speaking of color, I want to say I'm really happy to see red in the audience today.
Your father was a film producer who, you say, raised you almost as a mother would.
He was very maternal, and I remembered the other day that the kind of gifts he gave me were like really fine German train sets. So there was, a bit of confusion about whether I was his daughter or his son. And I loved that train set. I didn't have a problem with it. It got gondolé in a move, and I could never use it again. But he was he would take me to school. He would make me breakfast. He took care of me. My mother slept late. And I realized that I would make a bad mother because I sleep late too. And it's probably a reason I decided not to have any children, because You want to be there for your kid.
You move very early to France. Tell us a little bit about that magical setting that you take us to at the Pink.
Oh, the Palais Rose in Le Vésinet. Well, in 1953, when my grandparents rented it, Robert de Montesquieu was long gone. The Marchesa Cassati was remembered as cette vieille folle italienne avec les cheveux roux and trop de maquillage. And that had been, you know, 20, 30, 40 years before. It had been a rental for years. And it was a miniature version of the Trianon. But it was smaller. And it didn't have the extra wings, but it had the fountains, and it had the bath of Madame de Pompadour in the garden, but that was gone. And what it had was a furnace that was like a locomotive. You know, you'd open this door. it had urns everywhere. It had secret staircases. It had a sun. Set into a marble sun set into the floor, and when you switched on a light, the sun just shone from the floor. And so I found it completely magical and enchanting, but also completely magical. This was home. So this was a palace, so I had to be a princess. And I didn't understand that my father was having a terrible time trying to make movies and that it wasn't working, and he was traveling around trying to make things happen. And I didn't really understand anything except that the statues were really beautiful, and there were these ladies who were holding up tables. And I felt so sorry for the Caryatids, because they had, like, such a terrible job. And then finally I went to school, the Cour Racine du Vésinet. And we learned about Anton. Anybody here learn about Anton? Comment on dit Anton? Bugs.
No, I don't know which bugs those are.
They're sort of scarabs. They're French scarabs, which is why there's an H to begin the name. Anton. Si, yeah, but wrong country.
You live in this very sort of almost imaginary world.
Here's the thing. As expatriates in the 50s, my parents were imagining a Paris that's the Paris in the imagination of Americans. So my grandmother was always buying petit point handbags on the Rue de Rivoli, which no French woman buys. It's what you buy if you're American to take back to America. But she kept collecting the things that told her she was in Paris. And my parents would have meals at Fouquet's, and they would go to La Méditerranée. And they were living their imaginary Paris. And me, I was talking to the statues. So everybody had their own fantasy going.
What strikes us in the book is just these pivotal characters that show up in your life, really important people. And at one point, your father tells you that you have a godfather and that you are about to go and visit him.
It's a surprise because it's the first time I'd heard about a godfather. And I was French enough to be skeptical. What are you talking about? I said, I was 11. And he says, he's called John, and he has children and dogs and horses. Dogs and horses didn't interest me. Children was pretty interesting because I didn't really have many friends my age. We went to Ireland and I met this teeny little girl called Angelica, who was very, very small. And she got my comics immediately. And I met her mother, Ricky Soma, Enrica Soma, who'd been a ballerina for Balanchine. She had danced the Queen of the Willy in Giselle. And she was married to my godfather. And I saw this woman in a big bumpy sweater standing on the porch late at night greeting us. And she was so beautiful and so welcoming that I just kind of immediately went, because my mother had her cigarettes and she was always sort of very elegant but a little bit crisp and not that welcoming. And Ricky is the person I decided would be my mother. My mother was not necessarily pleased about this, but it was maybe a relief, you know?
You have a remarkable memory for what you've seen. These details pour out across the pages. You said, and I should ask you at this point, because it was my first question to you, how do you remember all of this?
I may have a deformation where I can't help but remember, so it's, I might try to forget. I get visual impressions very, very strongly. But they're visual, they're tactile. I don't remember things as events as much as moments, scenes. And then when I started keeping a diary, I started writing all the dialogue because I realized that if I only wrote what I felt, it was incredibly boring to reread. And when I was a teenager, I wanted to be able to go back into my diary and find out what happened. And the only way you can do that is with dialogue. And also photographs. My father had been a photographer, so he took thousands of photographs. And it's the bad photographs that jog the memory. It's not the posed ones where everybody looks gorgeous. It's the corner of the room with the dog and something over the chair. It's la photo ratée. And you go, I remember that day.
You were incredibly attracted to strong experiences. You moved quickly. You were attracted to people. By your early 20s, you're kind of an it girl in London. Writing, reporting.
The only job I ever really wanted was features editor of British Vogue. This was a job that was occupied by Marina Warner, who was brilliant, well-born, and had been to Oxford. I was not any one of those three things, but I wanted it. And my father made a film called The Ruling Class. The film went to Cannes. I went along with the film. And somebody there said that I could interview Robert Redford. I interviewed Robert Redford. The sum total of the interview on the tape was Robert Redford saying, take off your jacket. And I'm saying, no, I'm allergic to the sun. Can I have a citron pressé? But I came back to London and I managed to write something. And of course, I told everybody I had interviewed Robert Redford. So the editor-in-chief of British Vogue called me, wanted to see the interview, and said, well, it's really rather thin, dear. Beatrix Miller, she was remarkable. But she did offer me the job of replacing Marina Warner, who was going to Vietnam with her husband, Willie Shawcross. And for the princely sum of £10 a week, I was features editor of British Vogue at 23.
What was London like then, and what were you most interested in?
Probably at the age of 23, I was most interested in the effect that I was having on people. Mm-hmm. I think that's it goes with the age. I was also, features editor. I had a responsibility towards culture. And up until then, I had been selling underground newspapers outside the Café Flore. One of them, particularly the first European sex paper. I was very proud of standing outside the Flore holding up this thing. And so I felt that I owed an allegiance to what was then called the counterculture. So I'm putting Conrad Rooks in vogue, and I'm putting Andy Warhol in vogue, and I'm putting all these, this young woman I knew called Fran Lebowitz, I had her write something for Vogue, because I was going to make British Vogue kind of today. And it was easy because at the Lycée Français de Londres, a girl in my math class had a boyfriend called Manolo Blahnik. And Manolo Blahnik then started making shoes. So everything was part of the same thing.
And he was part of your close group of friends early on.
Yes, and you know, Manolo was, oh, ma chérie, je peux plus. A lot of that. Manolo speaks many languages, most of them at the same time. And the first shoes he made were very, very high heels with white, they were sort of pale beige crepe soles with leaves that tied the shoes onto your feet. But when the models came out in them, these very tall heels just bent. And the girls just went slowly down. And we all applauded, men, oh no, it's wonderful. But then he got it worked out, you know, he found a better factory.
I do want to just hit the pause button for one moment, because there is a moment where you do come back to the United States, to Sarah Lawrence.
Oh, yes.
And it is a wonderful moment, because when we talk about living between different cultures and understanding who we are when we come back to our own culture, you had quite a shock.
It was horrifying. I had never lived here. When I left Hollywood as a three-year-old, grapefruits were that big. Orange juice came in glasses that big, and everyone leaned down to talk to me. And when I came to Sarah Lawrence, the girls were all smoking dope and eating this ice cream called Haagen-Dazs that I didn't think tasted very good. And they were all protesting and doing these marches, girls say yes to boys who say no, which meant if you dodge the draft, we'll sleep with you. And I was a virgin. I didn't know that I'd how to deal with this. So I was in culture shock. And I had a wardrobe from London, and I spoke French, so I was immediately assumed to be well-versed in the wiles of the world. I was not.
You, in many ways, lead a very adult life at a young age, partly because you're an only child.
My first friend when I was 3 and a half was this movie director called Robert C. Odmack, who must have been in his 50s. But he was really fun to play with. And he'd run around on the floor with me, and you know, he'd make these funny bear faces. So yeah, I as an only child, I related to adults.
And there's a moment in the book where you write very openly about how surrounded you are by people that you care about so much, but also at a moment where you experience a lot of loss.
There were some really odd things I moved to New York to go to Sarah Lawrence, but these Sarah Lawrence girls alarmed me, so I dropped out as fast as I could, and I began writing book reviews for Glamour and became a fashion assistant. And I lived in my uncle's apartment that had two bedrooms on East 47th Street, and I was thrilled to be an adult living in this apartment, and I paid the rent, and I needed a roommate. And during the year when I was 20, three people who were in that apartment, stayed in that apartment, died. Different circumstances, but I found myself in September 1969, not yet 21, in this apartment where three people who'd been there had died, and I didn't understand what the causality, what the connection was between these events. There was no connection between the events, but they all were connected somehow to the apartment. I moved back to New York, to London. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was
a bit of a turning point for you. I have to talk about your love life, Joan.
That's all right.
Because you really...
Now that it's in the rearview mirror, it's absolutely fine.
Because you do write wonderfully about the intensity of your early romantic relationships, several of them with very well-known older men. I'd really like you to read a passage that you write right after you have met and fallen head over heels for the writer Tom Wolfe.
And you marked it. Thank you, Melissa. So he came to New York to write a series of articles for the London Weekend Telegraph about swinging London. It was swinging. He met me. I told him a lot of funny sentences. I was enchanted by him, and he wrote down everything I said. Imagine you're 17 years old, and the most famous journalist in the world is writing down everything you say. It was extraordinary. He went back to New York. I was in love. My father said, cut it out. But every word out of my mouth was Wolf. And if the conversation refused to cohere around Tom Wolf, I brought up every manner of wolf. Siberian wolf, timber wolf, wolf man, Steppenwolf, Howlin' Wolf. You should forget the wolf and find yourself a cub, said Ricky. Ricky being the very wise and wonderful Enrica Soma Houston, who I had adopted as my mother, even though I had a mother.
You didn't quite listen to her advice.
I couldn't find a cub. I didn't know where that sort of cub farm was.
And there were you had many admirers. There was something about your how would you describe it? Your personality that was magnetic?
I have absolutely no idea. The only thing I can imagine is if a man is talking about something that really interests me, I get really excited. And maybe I stare into their eyes with total admiration, and maybe that sets off a chain that leads to a lot of confusion and strangeness.
Leonard Cohen was an admirer of yours. Donald Sutherland, you write about.
Yeah, I do write about the affair that began in the swirling mists and fog of Parma in the fall of 1974 when Bernardo Bertolucci was making 1900, a film about the history of socialism in the first half of the 20th century, which was exactly the kind of subject that the Lycée Français de Londres had prepared me to be excited about. And it was misty, it was foggy, and I had just run away from a cub, actually, a young man my age who was half Austrian and half Bulgarian and had moved me to Rome with him and had tried to strangle me one morning at breakfast. So I was a little nervous of getting entangled with anyone. But I thought, I don't know what I thought, I was 26.
You write that when the lights go down and the sets fold.
Romances during movies, again, the thing of illusion. Magazines are illusions, movies are illusions. People who are making movies don't get enough sleep. They're woken at dawn to be made up and turned into other people. The technicians don't get enough. Nobody gets enough sleep. There's an intensity, there's a focus about the subject. There is nothing more heady than a group of people focusing on one purpose, on one thing. And in that swirl of intensities, of course people are falling in love. And even if they're not falling in love, they're certainly sleeping with each other. And when the movie is over, that intensity just dies away. And sometimes there are divorces. But,
you know. You take us to Paris, where you introduce us to a wonderful group of people. You take us on a tour of the fashion crowd in Paris, where you hang out with Pierre Berger, Hélène Rochat, Karl Lagerfeld, and Madison Cox, people that you all may be familiar with here. Tell us a little bit about this group that you baptized Le Petit Clan.
They baptized themselves, I think, the Petit Clan, which is a reference to Proust, I believe. Although, that chapter was originally called Exquisite Paris, when there were chapter headings in this book, which I got rid of because I couldn't actually think of a heading for each chapter. And it was Charlotte Ayot, best friends with Yves Saint Laurent. Pierre Berger, a complete Renaissance man who'd created Saint Laurent, but who also, what does he own now, Le Monde or Libération? I mean, so involved in culture, literature, theater, the arts, music. Hélène Rochas, who was still the head of Parfum Rochas, and had this thing called Lumière, this new perfume, which I thought was wonderful because Jeanne Moreau had just directed a movie called Lumière. So everything seemed to be part of the same circle. And around them were people of exquisite taste. Pierre Berger, we would go to theater and he would greet the production with either admirable. Or he would say exécrable. It was kind of one or the other. And I felt very excited. I was working on my second novel. I was living seven floors up on the Rue Guénégaud. The last two floors were almost impossible to climb, especially as the concierge used to really, really shine them with the wax on Mondays. So you could just go flying. So you had to kind of get up the last two floors like that. And I was working on this book. I was living in my imaginary world every day. And at night, if you're trying to work on a book in New York and you have dinner with people at night, they say, so what's your advance? How's it going? In Paris, they would say, oh, I don't know if that shade of blue is really the right one for you. They would never interfere with your work.
Do you consider it interference?
What, to ask you what your advance is or how it's doing?
Or how
yes,
your
that's,
book is doing.
Yes, that's interference. You don't want to think about your book. When you finished your day's work, you want two things. Food and diversion that's not about you.
What did you learn from them?
I learned, first of all, I didn't have a very good musical culture, and because Pierre Berger had Les Lundis Musicaux de l'Athénée with a Lieder concert every Monday, I learned, first of all, what Lieder is, who Janet Baker is, Margaret Price. I understood things about Schubert and Schumann that I had never even considered. I got a musical education from Pierre Berger. I got an education in behavior from Hélène Rochas.
What do you mean by that?
Ce qu'on fait, ce qu'on ne fait pas.
Can you give us some examples?
She had a very deep consideration for people's feelings. And and often it would come down to, if so-and-so is invited to dinner, they once had a fight with the husband of this person, but this person's now divorced from that husband, so maybe it's now okay. I mean, it was all about the energies that might be flowing between people.
And calibrating things.
Yeah, and calibrating things. And then the wonderful Nicole Wisniak, who does Egoist practically alone from her bed.
She seemed incredible.
She's fantastic. She produces Egoist, that beautiful magazine, when she feels like it. So it's been going since 1977, and I think there are maybe 14 issues. And sometimes there'll be one every year, and sometimes there'll be one year, and then nothing for 5 years. She's completely original and has the most exquisite taste and intelligence, and hates peaches. Despises fruit and will not eat peaches.
You eventually break away from the clan.
Well,
why is that?
I thought that this, you know, my life in Paris in the 80s when I lived in the Rue Guénégaud was every day being perched in that garret and then every evening being out wearing Saint Laurent with these very elegant people. And I thought, okay, this is kind of home. And one night, it was the reopening of the Centre Pompidou, or the opening of a certain gallery. And it was a cold, blustery night, and my very elegant friends were inside. And I think I was waiting outside for someone. And I saw the people, tous les invités, who were at this special event at the Pompidou. And I realized, apart from the petit clan, I had no idea who anyone was. And that I was not actually integrated at all into Paris. I was just kind of like a pretty little leaf floating in a cocktail somewhere in a corner of the room. And that it wasn't part of my life.
Of course, that was going to change.
Yes.
But in the meantime, you have an ability, Joan, to sort of redirect yourself fairly quickly. There's a line that in the book that says, the cards reshuffled into a new deck.
Yeah, I was talking about who would remarried who, but yeah.
But there is a sensibility that you have that skill in you. A positiveness.
Well, I have, I always think there's something interesting about to happen. And I think this was taught to me by my mother, who I wasn't that close with. But when we were the early years in Paris, she thought everything was wonderful. When, you know that noxious smell that comes out of the drains sometimes in France, and my mother would go, clams! So the fact that she could see fruits de mer in the smell of sewage, she taught me something about the attitude to have towards life.
At this point, you are a well-established writer. You've worked for Interview, Harper's and Queen, British Vogue, Women's Wear Daily, and
they paid me 10 times what Vogue paid me, £100 a week. It's huge.
You're offered the position at French Vogue, but you don't take it.
No, I turned it down a few times because it just seemed very boring to be sitting behind a desk telling people what to do. I didn't see where the fun was. And I also had this idea, this illusion in my head that I was an artist since I was writing these novels. But the evidence accumulated after I failed to write more than two novels that probably I wasn't an artist. And if I wasn't an artist and I couldn't write a third novel, what was I? Just a magazine writer, and that was pretty depressing. And then they offered me the job again, and I went, oh yes, thank God, I can do that.
The timing was good that time.
The timing was good. Also, the snow was falling, the kitty litter smelled very bad, and a man I really liked had just broken up with me, so it was perfect. I said yes.
You said yes, and we're now going to enter this really interesting period of your life. Very creative, also complicated.
Well, you know, anybody else who perhaps took over as editor-in-chief of a magazine might perhaps have had some experience as an editor in an office that would have lasted years, and they would have learned to manipulate people and how to move them around and how to get what you wanted. I hadn't worked in an office for 16 years, and I didn't have any kind of staff to bring with me to Paris because I only had the cleaning lady who stole. And that wasn't going to work. So I arrived in Paris completely naked, no backup. You know, I had a couple of friends, but I had to hire strangers. I had to make decisions on what stranger I would trust immediately to be my writer. I didn't know. I had no idea.
You inherit a team.
I inherited a team. There have been, as Melissa has very wonderfully pointed out, there are sort of odd things that happen in my life. So one of the things that happened, I inherited an assistant who was very brilliant. She was also editing Eric Rohmer's latest movie during her lunch hour, which I thought was impressive, but perhaps not what she should be doing because I had a lot of work for her to do. And one day, an American assistant had materialized who wanted to work for me, and it's the lunch hour, and this assistant is about to go off and edit Eric Rohmer's movie. And I said to her, are you happy working for me? And before she could answer, lightning hit the center of the Place du Palais Bourbon outside my office. And she went, no.
And off she went.
And off she went. So it was like, thank you.
There are moments of symbolism that come up like that, sort of signs that appear, and that you read into as well.
Well, I read, unfortunately, I spent many years in Jungian analysis because it was such fun. But it's given me this kind of fairy tale reading of everything that makes Freudians despise me, and that also probably at my age I should give up, except it's so much more fun to see people as witches and dragons. And,
You have this ability, Joan, to bridge two cultures, if not more, but certainly this French and American culture, that's one of the reasons why you are also invited to
be here.
To be here, but to take that original job. But with that comes a certain amount of responsibility.
I was good at the responsibility, I was just bad at the staff thing. And there was the responsibility to make a magazine that would be interesting for the reader. That was easy. Triple the volume of text and take out the adjectives. Way too many
You
adjectives.
Were very, very strict about that.
Yes. But there were what the advertiser wanted, and that was obvious because the advertiser pays for the magazine, so you want to show their clothes, but in a way that will be interesting to the reader. all of that was sort of a given. The thing that was much more difficult would be the person standing in front of me when I was trying to work something out saying, can I have her parking spot because she's never here? And I didn't know how to deal with those things. I also didn't know how to dress because as the editor-in-chief of French Vogue, I had to wear clothes that the advertisers made, even though my taste runs more to things maybe the advertisers didn't make, but I had to make them happy. So I had a great many jackets because it would be lunch with the advertisers and they only cared about what they could see. So I would wear these jackets and then I'd wear somebody else's coat and the things wouldn't go together. And I hadn't worn shoes during the day for 16 years and the high heels
killed you. It was a beautiful magazine. I remember the themes that you introduced. They were conceptual themes. Tell us a little bit about how you thought about what was relevant
until,
at the time.
From 1969 until I arrived, there was a guest editor for each French Vogue issue. And the guest editors were sometimes incredibly famous people, but they didn't really do the work, so it was built around the idea of them. I said to the staff, you're good enough to make Vogue. The rest of the year, you're good enough to make it at Christmas. The first theme was easy. I'd been a movie critic for 8 years. So we did 100 years of cinema. It was extraordinary. The second one was the 75th anniversary of Vogue. That was easy. Art was fantastic because, for instance, David LaChapelle, who I'd brought in, who'd never done a fashion shoot before he came to Vogue, and whose first fashion shoot was a remake of Blade Runner for the 100 years of cinema, with particularly a replicant talking into a Chanel shoe. One of my favorite pictures. Anyway, David LaChapelle did a Jeff Koons of a girl with puppies and funny hair, and he did the spiral jetty. We did a great art thing, and they would come out of the clothes because during the fashion season, we'd all be sitting there watching the shows, waiting for the shows and watching. And I wanted everyone on the magazine to collaborate. So I would do this thing that people did not like. We would have 3 days of slideshows of everything we'd seen so that each person could react. And people could choose the thing that they cared about the most and therefore go with the thing they were passionate about. And so this quantum physics issue basically came out of the fact...
Which was quite amazing that you pulled that one off, Joan.
Yeah. Victor and Rolf showed a suit that looked like a cell in the process of dividing itself. Prada showed white dresses with dots and lines on them. And everybody was getting kind of abstract. And it was 1998 to 1999. We were almost at the millennium because if you're Paris Vogue, you want to be ahead of everybody, like by a year. There were great things being, DNA, the DNA code was being figured out. I ordered a DNA plastic code model kit from America. And when it arrived, nobody knew how to put it together. We had to have a student, like in the office for weeks with these balls. And then when it was finished, it was ugly. We couldn't even photograph it. Everything would come together organically out of what we had seen at the fashion shows. But it wasn't until we were looking at the slideshow, having slept and been fed, that we could go, oh, that looks like... And the ideas would come from all kinds of different people in the rédaction.
And you had this wonderful creative energy, and you did bring it out in others as well, even though you may not give yourself credit for managing
people. C'était un vrai foisonnement. And it was extraordinary to feel people's creative energy, passion, intensity rise about a certain subject, and then somebody else would say, oh, but I could do this with it. And this thing would build. Meanwhile, the poor student's there with the DNA in the other room and it's not working, but the magazine was working.
The magazine was working, and what was also sort of touching about that time in your life is that you were also very attentive to your parents.
Well, my father, who'd been prodigiously successful in London in the 60s with Peter O'Toole, then lost everything and went back to Los Angeles with my mother, having become British, just him, went back to Los Angeles, and they had, it wasn't a miserable life, but it was a reduced life. And he no longer elicited the respect that he'd gotten when he was important in London. And as his daughter, and because of our closeness, I wanted to restore that to him. And after my mother died, he was in Los Angeles, a widower alone, telling young women in supermarkets about how beautiful his wife had been. And I thought it would be nicer if he were in Paris. I brought him over to Paris, a short time in my apartment, that was a little complicated, got him his own apartment, got him a wonderful woman to just hang out with him, be his companion, and then somebody else to take care of another part of his life. And this woman who took care of him, Anita Clark, one day says, I can cook. And I said, great, let's have some parties. And she would cook for these huge dinners for 50 people, and my father would arrive late, and somebody important or famous or beautiful would see him standing at the door and go and take his coat and bring him and sit him down, and somebody else would bring him a plate of food that Anita, who took care of him every day, had cooked for the dinner party. And he said this line that I put in the book. He said to somebody one night, you know, she's my chef, but at home I have her do simpler things. So I was able, because of the job, to recreate this thing around my father that he'd lost, that circumstances had taken away from him. And it wasn't that I was that rich or that famous, but I could create that illusion. And because of Vogue, my guests could be the kind of people that he wanted to see. And that became almost more important than the job.
To the point where when you realize that the job might slip, that's your first preoccupation.
It was my first preoccupation because, as I said, I wasn't earning that much money, and all this stuff cost a lot, especially, I found out later that he used to take, I had a taxi service, that he would take a taxi from his apartment to a cafe two blocks away and have the driver wait while he read the Herald Tribune for 2 hours. Made him feel good, great. But anyway, so a lot of money had gone. So when I was told that I had to take a 2-month sabbatical and go to a rehab, even though I've never had any kind of drug problem, and that if I didn't go, it would be quitting, my first thought was, how am I going to take care of Dad? So I went, because much like my mother, smelling the shit coming out of the drain and going clams, I went, this is going to be interesting.
And I have to say that is a splendid part of the book, actually.
It's funny, huh?
It really is, and I'm not going to give anything away, if only to say that one of your core qualities, but also one of your most resilient qualities, is this ability to find the interesting in even the most difficult moments, and to inquire as to what's happening. And you meet people there, and you talk to people there, and you kind of become a reporter again.
Well, you know, when you're told that your job being editor-in-chief of French Vogue is turned into a sabbatical for 2 months and you're going to a rehab, you go into a kind of shock. But at that point, I had been writing for Vogue since I was 23. I was then 51. And the idea that Vogue was sending me somewhere, putting me on a plane to go do something, oh, it's an assignment. So I got a new notebook and I got a bunch of felt tip pens. And I thought, I'm gonna write about this. You can't take photos in a rehab, and a lot of the people with real drug problems would get upset when they'd see me writing as they were explaining their lives. Somebody would say, no, you know, Oh, okay. But I just took notes and I drew a lot of cactuses because it was in Tucson. It was extraordinary after 6.5 years of being among people who are on show and fabulously well-dressed and sitting in the front row and making a small talk and probably on pep pills, diet pills, who knows what, to be among people who are crying most of the time and who've also lost whatever they just had. And maybe it wasn't reality, because it was, of course, the formula of a rehab, but nonetheless, it felt like authenticity. And it felt more authentic than Paris. And I had a revelation. Honnêteté?
Absolument.
So they tried to throw me out, because I didn't have any reason to be there. And the director said, go. And I said, you know, I'm an expatriate. I have nowhere to go. I had left my father in New York. In Paris. I had lied to him. I said I was going on a biking tour of Laguna Beach. I don't know why. But I didn't want to say I've been sent to a rehab. And I said, I want to stay. And my father has mental problems. My father was manic depressive. I thought, maybe I am as well, so I can find that out here. You know, this will be. So I took the test, said I wasn't. And I did all the sort of easy things. I did Sex Addicts Anonymous. I did Adult Children of Alcoholics. I did Codependence Anonymous, Anger Management. But the people I became friends with were hardcore addicts. And they said to me, will you stop fucking around with these easy little things? Come do what we do. Come to the Narcotics Anonymous meeting. And I'm thinking, oh, you know, I really like my drug addict friends, and I'm just going to humor them. And it's nothing to do with me, because I'm so much purer than they are, because I've never had a drug problem. So I go, and we're sitting in a circle, and this woman with sort of dirty long hair gets up, and she's got a pink parka that's very noisy. And she says, she's a poodle groomer. And she says, I was grooming the pups and buying the coke and grooming the pups and buying the coke and taking the coke and grooming more pups. And finally, I realized I couldn't afford the coke if I was grooming the pups, so I'll deal the coke. At which point, I jump up from my seat, and I say, that's me in Vogue. I was addicted to Vogue. I had to become a dealer in that illusion so as to afford the life around Vogue. And my addict friend said, you see?
There is a line in your book, Joan, that speaks to that, and I just want to read it because it highlights exactly what you're saying. You wrote, Vogue is a potent drug that women get lost in. Mm-hmm. We are making more than magazines. We are making the most addictive substance there is, the dream. And there is a huge responsibility in making dreams.